Well, hello again and good afternoon, everyone. In the next 30 minutes or so, I would like to take you to take a look at some aspects of Chatback Compose. I would like to take a closer look at some aspects. As I've said before, I've come from imperative frameworks, and no matter which framework you choose, if it's the old Android View system or if it's Swing or Java FX or any other thing, they have some quite a lot of patterns in common. And I was curious to see if these patterns still work in the new declarative world, and if they don't work, how should it be done instead? I'm frequently on Twitter, so if you have questions or if you want to reach out to me, just feel free to contact me. Also, the slides of this talk are on SpeakerDeck, so feel free to take a look at them afterwards. Most of the examples I'll be showing here in this talk are also on GitHub, so you find the repo here. After the talk, I'll also Twitter them, so no need to write it down right now. Right, so what will I be talking about in the next 30 minutes? I'd like to start with the anatomy of traditional UI frameworks. I think it's important to reacquaint oneself with how things used to work so that we can better compare them with how things work now in the declarative world. Also, I'd like to take a little closer look at modifier, because in my opinion, modifier play a very important role, and the way we amend existing components has changed drastically from the imperative world to Jetpack Compose. Third section will be brief look at how we use Canvas, and I'd like to finish the talk with some reflections on the use of threads. So let's start with the anatomy of traditional UI frameworks. You see, most UI frameworks were long based on components, and these components are either classes or data structures. If they are classes or data structures, briefly depends on the underlying operating system and, of course, depend on the programming language that is used. Of course, when using classes, we can benefit from real dependency, whereas using plain data structures, other mechanisms need to be used. What they all have in common is that the UI is defined through component trees, and these component trees can be defined either in code. That's what Swing fellows have been doing for quite a long time, but it is also possible to define these component trees in some sort of markup language. As you can see here, Android is using XML as a markup language. We have a linear layout that includes three components, a text view and an edit text and a button. Any component has attributes that can or should be altered, and everything we are doing with the user interface relies on modifying these attributes. Why am I stressing this fact? Because if there is no attribute to change some sort of behavior, then there is no way of changing this behavior. And as you'll see shortly, this is much easier for us to achieve with Jetpack Compose. During runtime, this component tree is represented either as an object tree or as a nested data structure. Again, this depends on the programming language we use. For example, there was a time we built our user interfaces with plain C being no object-oriented programming language, but we had these fiddlings with pointers and pointers of pointers and dereferencing pointers. That is weird stuff. Very glad we no longer have to deal with this. But what to change the UI, we change the component tree. And again, if you take a look at my example, changing this component tree means either changing attributes or setting some listeners. Other frameworks call these callbacks, but in the end, it's the same. If you want to be notified if the user has pressed the button, you register some callback, and once the user clicks this button, your code in the callback is notified. And this works the same in Android, in Swing, and in Java FX, and in most other UI frameworks that implement this imperative way of doing things. We also see two main groups of components. So if you take a look at the components UI frameworks offer, you can divide them into elements that the user can interact with, for example, buttons, checkboxes, or text fields. And the other group being elements that are there for laying out or structuring other elements. Usually, these layout elements are invisible to the user, but nonetheless, they are very crucial because without them, you would not be able to build more complex user interfaces. Think of just putting them in a row or in a column is, of course, not enough. So you need ways to structure your user interface, and that's what these layout elements are for. I've already mentioned that briefly. Most now imperative UI frameworks are based on inheritance, which means that any UI element takes the mechanics of an ancestor and modifies or enriches it. As an example, I chose a button. As you probably all know, in Android, we have the button widget, which extends text view, which in turn extends view, which now it's no longer interesting, extends Java lang object. Of course, there are also children to the ordinary button, for example, a checkbox being a specialized form of the button. As I said, other frameworks do it in a similar way. In Java Swing, we had the so-called JButton, which extended an abstract button, which in turn extended a component. You get the idea. Now, but what are we supposed to do if no available UI component suits our requirements? So, for example, what should we do if we needed a button that is shown as a circle or as a triangle or something like that? Well, obviously, we need to create custom components. Creating custom components invokes picking a suitable ancestor and modify or enhance it. Of course, this works well if we have one parent that provides all base functionality that we need for our custom component. But what if we need features from different components? Then we have two paths we can follow. The first path being just combining existing UI components. I'll be focusing on this on the next slides. And the other path being, well, just doing it completely on our own means doing all the drawing, doing all the painting, and doing all the handling of events on my own. Now, as you can see here, in Android, it's quite easy to build a custom component that combines existing components. In my example, I decided to create an editable checkbox. How this editable checkbox would look like, you can see on the right-hand side of the screen. It actually is a relative layout that includes a checkbox and an edit text. And now, what's important here is that you not only need to combine the existing UI elements, you need to provide everything you want to be able to control from inside your application, you need to provide this as an attribute. Remember what I said earlier, if there is no attribute for doing something in a component, it can't be done. That's why I provided a property that is called text and another property I called checked, which can be controlled from the outside, and they actually modify the existing Android views. Now, how would this look in the declarative world? Here I've created a composable, it's also called editable checkbox. What's different is that I do not store state inside my composable code, but I ask the user of my composable to pass it to the composable, which makes my code beautifully stateless and therefore reusable very easily. The underlying mechanics, however, are pretty much the same. I have a composable I use for laying out the children, which is a row, which you all know, and the row lays out components horizontally. And also I add a checkbox and I add a text field. So the mechanic of combining things here remains the same. What differs is that I do not try to provide some sort of attributes that can be modified from the outside, but I want the developer to pass everything that is needed to actually work with my composable to it. So as you've seen in ChatBig Compose, we combine building blocks, but as being functions, there is no traditional class-based inheritance. Of course, composables can be polymorph. For example, for a text field, you can either pass a simple string or you can pass something that's called a text field value. And just like traditional views, composables are nested. As you've seen in my example, the row includes a checkbox and it includes a text field. What's also interesting that often composables delegate functionality to generalized versions. For example, if we take a look at how the checkbox composable is implemented, we see that it actually delegates its functionality to something that's called tri-state checkbox. It's also composable, and it gets all the stuff it needs to work. And in a way, we get some sort of inheritance without object orientation, but do not take this too seriously, please, because what we see here is, of course, no inheritance, but what we see here is delegating functionality. And I think this is a pattern that we should use whenever possible in our composable user interfaces, because this way we can get rid of redundancy, because we can we do not need to repeat ourselves. So here's how you can actually use the tri-state checkbox. To use it, you will need a state. As you can see here, I'm remembering a mutable state of something that's called toggleable state. It's actually an enum, which has three values, intermediate, on, and off. And in the onClick callback, I am simply cycling through these states. And as you can see, off means nothing ticked, intermediate means dashed, and on means checked. Now let's turn to modifier. You have seen, and you probably already know, that mostly the look and the behavior of composable can be configured through parameters. You've seen this in my examples. For example, I've been passing text to the text composable, but we can also modify the look and the behavior by means of modifier. And the modifier is an ordered immutable collection of so-called modifier elements. Now, modifier is both an interface and a companion object. Most important of the interface is the then function. As you'll see shortly, implementing this then function can be both simple and complex, depending on what we need to achieve. Here is an extension function I've been written. It's called draw on yellow because the name pretty much says what this extension function is doing. I'm invoking a method called drawRect, and I'm passing yellow as the color to it. And this is passed to something that's called drawBehind. What drawBehind comes from, we'll see shortly. Here's how we use it. We just have a text composable. It receives my modifier. And if we run this, it looks like this. Now let's take a look at how drawBehind works. As you see, drawBehind receives a lambda. This lambda acts. Just a second. This lambda acts as an extension function to drawScope, and therefore we can use in our lambda, we can use everything that we get from the drawScope. You also have to pass something that's called inspector info. I'll be showing you in a couple of slides what this inspector info is used for and how you can utilize it. What's important to note here is that what we pass to then, please remember that then is the function that comes from the modifier interface. So what we pass to then is an object. In this case, it's a private class called drawBackgroundModifier. And it's important to note that this drawBackgroundModifier extends both drawModifier and inspectorValueInfo. And what it does actually, it first invokes my onDraw lambda. You recall this was the code that I was passing in, for example, passing in a yellow rectangle. And afterwards, a function called drawContent is invoked, which draws the actual content. So this way, we can put something behind. Now, a few words on DrawScope. DrawScope creates a scoped drawing environment with a provided canvas, which provides a declarative stateless API to draw shapes and paths without requiring consumers to maintain the underlying canvas state information. As I've already said, we'll take a little closer look at canvas a little bit later. Here is another example how modifiers can work. Here you can see the source code of fill max width, which is a function that comes with Jetpack Compose. Again, as you see here, then is invoked, and this way then receives a fill modifier. Again, this fill modifier implements an interface. This time it's called layout modifier, and the layout modifier in turn implements or extends modifier elements. So what is important to note here is that whenever we want to implement our own extension function to modifier and we want to use this dot then, we need to have an instance of something that at least implements the modifier element, because that's what the contract in the modifier interface says. As I've said, there's also a modifier companion object, and this modifier companion object can be used as the start of a modifier extension factory expression. Now, this word monster may sound scary. First, let's take a look at how we use the companion object. As you've seen here, I've composable. This time it's a canvas. it receives a modifier. It also receives the onDraw callback, and this way it knows and it invokes another composable called spacer, and invokes modifier drawBehind with onDraw. Here's another example of a modifier extension function. This time we can see part of how borders are drawn. You see this time Jetpack Compose does not directly invoke then. Instead, it invokes Composed, which receives two parameters, a factory and again an inspector info. And this time the factory invokes this dot then. Now what this does, it returns the result of a composed modifier, which receives a factory and an inspector info. Now let's see how composed works. Now finally composed does invoke then. It invokes then with a composed modifier, which receives the two parameters we put in. So the factory is on the one hand side a plain composable, and on the other hand, it's also an extension function to modifier. And this is wrapped inside a composed modifier, and this one is then passed to then. The composed modifier is a private class that extends inspector value info. And of course, it needs to implement modifier element, which, as you already know, is a single element that's contained within a modifier chain. Now, what's this inspector info about? If you implement your own extension functions to modifier, you may want to peek into some of its values during debugging. And to do this, you need to set one variable to true. It's called is debug inspector info enabled. And afterwards, you can use your modifier by casting it to inspectable value. And once you've done that, you get access to a list of inspectable elements. You can iterate over them. I'm doing just simple things here. I'm printing out the name and the value of this element. And if you run the scope, you can see at the bottom of the screen how the debug output would look like. Now you may be asking yourself, when should I use then and when should I use a factory? My impression is that if you do not need the inspector info, the direct use of then might be simpler. To illustrate this, here's another extension function of modifier. This time I've called it drawRedCross. I'm using a function that's called drawWithContent. This function draw with content is provided through the content draw scope. And here we have two lines that are drawn, one from the upper left corner to the lower right corner, and the other one vice versa. And now, why is it drawn in front of a text? That's because I have put draw content as the first instruction in my lambda. So if you want to change the order when things are drawn, you just need to put draw content at the location where or when you want to see the actual content. Now, as we've seen so far, modifiers amend both the look and the behavior of components. But what do we do if a component should not be altered, but should be designed from scratch? Remember that I said going this path, we should do all the drawing on our own. In an imperative UI framework, all UI elements share one common root. This common root defines all the mechanics that a UI element must provide. It usually includes size and location and a contract how to represent itself on screen. And depending on the framework, this may be called onDraw, or it may be called paint, or but there is one central paint method that you need to implement, and the code you put there relates to what the user will be seeing on screen. Now let's see how we could do this in Compose. The following two slides will be showing you examples of how we use the canvas. The second one being a circle with some linear gradient, and the first one being two lines, a red dot and a dashed circle outside it. Now, as you see, I've implemented a composable that uses the canvas composable. We need to specify both width and height for the canvas. Here I say that I want to have the complete width, but the preferred height of my canvas should be 128 density independent pixels. And also what you need to provide is a callback. This on draw callback, in my first example, draws two lines and draw two circles. As you see, I pass in solid colors, but you could also pass something that's called a brush, which you would need if you want to do gradients or things like that. We'll see that soon. Here I pass a style, which is a stroke. I say the stroke should be 8 physical pixels width, and I would want to use a path effect. This time it's a dash path effect. This is the dashed line round the red circle you see on the previous slide. Here's another example of how we could use canvas. Again, I want the canvas to use the max width and have a preferred height of 128 density independent pixels. This time I only define a gradient. Maybe you've seen one of my articles on Dev2 in the previous week. In my example, I was using something that was just called linear gradient. Here we see a modification. They moved the linear gradient inside brush. But actually, Jetpack Compose is still alpha, so it's perfectly okay to face breaking changes. Now, I would like to end my insights on how to use modifiers and how to use canvas. And now I would like to turn to threads. Again, a recap of the imperative UI framework. Practically all UI frameworks are single threaded. This means that all manipulation of the component tree must be done on a specific thread, and this particular thread must never be blocked. And what this means and how we will be doing this in the declarative world, I'm now going to show you with some real code. Just give me a second. Yes. Maybe zoom a little more in. As you can see, this is an example how we would have been doing things with the traditional Android view system. I'll run this example. If I click the button, I say hello DevFest. Now, what if I want to get the result from, say, a web service? Just need to start it. This time it's still a Spring Boot application, but I think I should rewrite it, for example, using Ktor. Now, as you see, I've got a function that says get hello, and it just receives the content from the web service and trying to print it. Now, if I run this, I think that this is the demo effect. Actually, this should not be working. Actually, we should be seeing an exception because I'm doing a network access, and the network access is blocked from the main thread. Actually, I will not concentrate on trying to get this to run. I'll show you how we would eventually fix it. Because that's what the gist I wanted to show you. If we have some long-running tasks, we must not issue this long-running task on the main thread on Android, but we need to do it on some other thread. And the most simple implementation, something you definitely would not want to do in your production application, is just spawning a new thread, then invoking the network access, and once you receive the result, you would pass the result to the view hierarchy, and this you would need to do on the main thread again. So, and now let's take a look at how this would look on in the declarative world. I'm again switching branches. As you see, I have a very simple composable. It's called content. It uses a column, and the column consists of a button and a text. And again, I'll try to, I was using the wrong launch configuration. That explains it. I'm very sorry. I got completely confused. I was using the wrong launch configuration, so the demo had no chance to crash. Now I'm on the right one again, running this one. Clicking the button says "Hello DevFest." Now switching to the next iteration. Now, what would happen if I also had a function called get hello, and I would want to invoke the get hello from inside my composable? Let's run it. I'm confident that this time it will crash. Fortunately, it does. And you see, it crashes because of the scroll a little bit more upward. Because we are trying to access the UI from the wrong thread. Now let's see how we can try to fix it. You see, I've modified my composable. This time I'm passing in a state and a callback. This is quite handy because I want my composable to be stateless whenever possible. So what should happen when the user clicks the button should not be defined inside the composable, but should be passed in from the outside. So this way I can just invoke the provided callback. And also, although my state needs to be a mutable state because I obviously need to change it, that's not of interest for my composable because inside the composable, the state is not changed. So I can pass it in as just plain state. Now, as I know that I must call the network stack from another thread, I try it this way. I say thread and afterwards I say message.value gleich get hello. Now, if I try to run this, you'll see it won't work either. Again, demo effect. Now I'm completely clueless. Maybe it's because mostly the end of the talk. Nonetheless, I'll show you how things used to be working. Probably I got confused with the branches. In Jetpack Compose, it's sufficient to put the thing inside thread because when modifying the state, we are not directly in need of being on the main thread because this is handled behind the curtains. But what I want to stress is that this is definitely not the way you should be doing things. It's just a very brief example to describe the mechanics of the Compose, but you probably would be using a combination of live data and view model, or you might be switching to Kotlin flows. But this should be, of course, be enough information for another talk. So now I'm switching back to the slides. I almost finished. Now it's time for a short wrap up. You see, using Jetpack Compose is great fun. As you've also seen, be ready to expect changes because as we're still in alpha, some things may change over time. But nonetheless, feel free to start exploring Jetpack Compose early because it will soon be rocking the stage and we need to adapt our knowledge as soon as we can. And the final point I would like to give you as a takeaway, as I did, take a look under the hood to understand how Compose works. Pay close attention to how the Compose library works and try to distill best practices from there. So now that's the end of my talk. I hope you enjoyed my presentation. Thanks a lot for listening. And now I'm open to questions.
All right, thank you very much, Thomas, for this interesting talk and also for illustrating it so much with the examples. Mm. So to see a lot of ways how it applies. And to me, it was like maybe to, if you zoom out a little bit, mm-hmm. what is the big conceptual takeaways? So because it's different paradigms of thinking to come from an imperative world and go into a declarative. So what is for you like the biggest mental attitude or like the biggest switch in how you think about code and how you think about applications?
The overall revelation to me was to get rid of thinking in components. We were hammered in that everything is a component, and if you want to change things, you need to change attributes inside these components. And this is no longer the case. We must think in much more smaller pieces, and we must encourage ourselves to make use of those many small pieces. In the imperative UI frameworks, those components tended to be monolithic and tended to be big, and any change you applied might have had severe consequences. And Jetpack Compose is a really nice toolbox with lots of small pieces, and we are really free to combine these small pieces as we choose.
Mm-hmm. Okay, maybe it's because I only see praise in the comments, but no questions. So I'm gonna pick it up and ask another questions. But please, everyone, feel free to type down questions. We still have 7 minutes. So another question is towards the beginning. You said how did they used to work, those components? How do they work now? That was kind of your introduction. Mm-hmm. And maybe you can make a third step and say, how should they work? So is there anything that you think that would make it easier or would make it better or easier to jump on doing the switch to be like onboarded into the world without compromising the declarative mindset?
Actually, Google is putting a lot of effort into code labs and bringing the folks that have been doing the traditional Android view system up to speed. So actually, from what I've learned so far, I must say, I don't see anything that could be made even better. I think getting too used to Jetpack Compose is rather easy, but actually what I would like to see is, and of course Google still needs to explain this to us, how we bridge some of the gaps we are currently facing. For example, if I would want to do an app widget, I currently need to do this using the traditional Android view system, because at least as far as I know, there is no bridge from the composable world to some older stuff. So I wouldn't know how to use a composable to build up an app widget. And that's what I would like to see in the future. Help us Google understand how they think things should be going there. But the mechanics of the composable, I mean, composables have gone quite a long way. You probably recall from my examples, I used the remember function quite a lot. It hasn't been there from the beginning. There was a time, there even was a model thing that we had to use while building composables, and then there was the state thing. So Jetpack Compose has come a long way, and I'm not deep inside enough to say it's production ready or not, but actually I personally don't see any additional needs, or I wouldn't have any wishes. I just want that thing to rock, and hopefully we can see less and less breaking changes. So this is maybe the one thing that makes the learning curve a little bit higher than it could be, because if you take a look at code examples on the internet, or if you see some tutorials on Medium or DevTool, you need to be prepared that the code you are seeing there no longer works because Compose moved on, and of course there must be some time at this stop, so we need to get a fixed look at least the first version that's production ready. That this is something I would wish for.
Mm-hmm. So more stability or backward compatibility.
Yeah.
Basically, yeah. To have more consistent learning material.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I think it makes it also hard that universities, this is still a big factor for people that like have an entry into the professional life, that they are still very much focused on imperative programming, yeah, and not often the most modern way of imperative programming. Yeah. And so I think there's like a need for good making the transition easy for junior developers who are already overwhelmed by all the new things, by all the expectations that they think that everybody has of them, and imposter syndrome, and then on top they have to like entirely switch their mind. Would be really nice to have like a stable and friendly learning environment.
Right.
To like work easier with modern technologies. Okay, so maybe less of a question, more of a statement or of my call. I don't know if there's anyone with a question, at least not in the in the chat. I'll still give you another minute to pose a quick question, and otherwise, you know, ask the speaker at DevFest Dach online. Send us an email. We'll make sure to forward it to Thomas. And last chance for a question.
Maybe one more apologies from my side. I completely got lost in my Git branch, so probably should not have been doing this. But I thought actually doing live coding has its pitfalls too. So I thought I might be on the safe path at switching branches, but obviously it didn't work too well. So sorry for that.
I think like you, we should not strive for this perfection that everything works all the time and is really shiny. Because, you know, how often do you did you see like tutorials or videos and everything seem extremely easy and no problems and whatever, then you try to do work on it yourself and then everything crashes. So we have this expectation that that everything needs to work perfectly. And then we're very frustrated when we sit down and we're like, how can I not figure this out? Right. And so it's good actually to see glitches and to get some confidence, like, come on, this is real life,
right?
You need to take risks. And I mean, maybe that's like my one big criticism in like learning material, that it seems like teachers don't like fuck up or have glitches or struggle with things. And it's just nice to see that the real life is messy. All right, good. So thank you so much, Thomas.
It was a pleasure. You're welcome. Thanks a lot.